Hello and welcome to the International Daily Roundup by People's Dispatch, where we bring you major news developments from around the world. Our headlines: dozens killed in rising crackdown in pro-democracy protests in Swaziland. Journalists and activists among those killed in overnight shootings in Haiti. Protests break out in Sudan as government announces IMF debt relief deal. And in our video section, we take a look at the demolition of Palestinian buildings in occupied Jerusalem's Silwan area. In our first story, over 40 people have reportedly been killed in the crackdown on Swaziland's pro-democracy protests. The People's United Democratic Movement, or PUDEMO, has stated that around 150 have sustained gunshot injuries. Several protesters are in a critical stage and limited information is available due to internet blackouts. While curfews have been imposed, security forces have carried out numerous attacks after barging into homes. The government hospital in Mbabane has admitted 50 people with gunshot wounds by Wednesday morning. Dozens of similar injuries have been reported in Manzini and other places. The people of Swaziland have been protesting to demand an end to the rule of King Maswati III. The absolute monarch controls the country's political system and the economy. As protests spread, people have blocked roads and set fire to properties and businesses owned by the king. Amid reports that Maswati had fled the country, people are continuing to mobilize in rural and urban areas. Security forces also opened fire on a demonstration held in the town of Simunye on Wednesday. Several people were then arrested. When residents marched to the local police station to demand their release, police opened fire again, injuring several people. The Communist Party of Swaziland has stated that a 14-year-old child was killed in Matsafa on Wednesday. A beverages company partly owned by the king was set on fire by protesters on Tuesday. The CPS has stated that security forces killed several protesters and dumped their bodies into fire. Meanwhile, PUDEMO has stated that hundreds of people have been forcibly disappeared. In our next story, we go to Haiti, where at least 15 people were killed in overnight shootings on June 29th. Among them were journalist Diego Charles and political activist Antoine Duclair. The shootings took place in several areas in Port-au-Prince. This was shortly after a spokesperson of a local police union was killed by unidentified men. The National Police Chief, Leon Charles, said that the allies of the killed officer were responsible for the mass shooting. As reported by AFP, the union known as Phantom 509 was in open conflict with the police force. Local media reported that Diego Charles and Duclair were shot by unidentified men on motorcycles. Activists and journalists are now calling for a proper investigation. The killing of Diego Charles follows the killing of two journalists in 2019. Another journalist, Vladimir Legagnier, went to the Martisan neighborhood in 2018 and was not heard from again. The police have not released the findings on any of these cases. Protests were held in Port-au-Prince on Wednesday as people placed burning tires on roads. There has been a surge in kidnapping and gang violence, which has targeted poor and working class areas. As per the International Organization for Migration, over 17,000 people were displaced in Port-au-Prince between June 1st and 24th. Meanwhile, activists have pointed to the nexus between the government, the police and the gangs. A report released in April 2021 showed how the police and government provided gangs with money, weapons and vehicles. Meanwhile, Haiti has already been witnessing mass protests against the de facto president Jovenel Moïse. He's ruling by decree and has refused to step down, claiming that his term will end only in 2022. Despite widespread opposition, he has announced that parliamentary elections will be held in September. Meanwhile, a referendum on a new constitution has been indefinitely postponed. In our next story, we go to Sudan, where protests were held in several cities on June 30th. People are demanding that the transitional government resign as economic conditions worsen. Wednesday's protests followed a day after the IMF approved a $2.5 billion loan and debt relief deal with the government. The agreement will see Sudan's external debt reduced by $50 billion over 3 years. However, the reforms have led to cuts in subsidies and doubled the price of petrol and diesel. Hundreds of people took to the streets of Khartoum and marched to the presidential palace on Wednesday. They raised the chance of "we want the fall of the regime, no to IMF policies and bread for the poor." Protesters also burned tires and security forces deployed tear gas to disperse the crowd. People from the twin cities of Omdurman, Twin City of Omdurman, also attempted to join the protests. Sudanese Professionals Association reported the use of rubber bullets and arbitrary arrests in several areas. June 30th also marked 2 years since the Millions March demonstrations held in 2019. Tens of thousands of people had held protests following the June 3rd massacre in Khartoum. At least 128 people were injured and killed, and over 700 people were injured when armed forces stormed a sitting demonstration. The attack was led by the paramilitary Rapid Support Forces formed under the ousted dictator Omar al-Bashir. The transitional government announced an inquiry into the massacre in 2019. However, the findings have still not been made public. This has led to protests every year to demand justice for the victims. Protests were held again in Sudan's Kassala region on Wednesday. Unrest has also grown as people condemned the major role of the military in the government. Moreover, issues such as unemployment and poverty, which led to the 2019 revolution, still remain unaddressed. And for our final story, we look at the destruction of Palestinian property in occupied East Jerusalem. A butcher shop owned by the Al-Rajabi family in Silwan was demolished by Israeli authorities earlier this week. Another apartment building in the Al-Suwayh neighborhood was also destroyed. Demolition orders have been issued for buildings in the Al-Bustan neighborhood, affecting over 1,500 Palestinians. Out of them, 13 families are at immediate risk of losing their homes. Here is a video feature on the current situation in Silwan.
The Palestinian neighborhood of Silwan in the occupied East Jerusalem has become the latest target of illegal Israeli demolitions. At least 13 Palestinians were injured and 3 arrested by security forces during demonstrations against illegal demolitions by Israel on June 29th. Israeli forces, accompanied by bulldozers, began the demolitions in the morning, citing a court order. 17 Palestinian-owned establishments had received demolition orders issued by the Israeli-controlled Jerusalem municipality on June 7th. The demolitions of the structures will affect 13 Palestinian families, consisting of around 130 people. Israeli authorities also plan to demolish close to 100 Palestinian homes in the Al-Bustan area, citing illegal construction and lack of mandatory building permits. The idea is to construct a religious-themed King's Garden National Park. The plan will benefit illegal Israeli Jewish settlers living in East Jerusalem. It will also displace over 1,500 Palestinian residents of Al-Bustan. Approximately 33,000 Palestinians in the whole of Silwan neighborhood are also under constant threat of authorities demolishing and confiscating their homes, property, and lands. The demonstrations and sit-in protests on Tuesday, which began in Al-Bustan, spread to other parts of Silwan like Batn al-Hawa and Bir Ayub. The protests were met with excessive force by the Israeli forces and riot police, who used tear gas, stun grenades, metal batons and rubber-coated bullets to suppress them. Palestinians assert that the demolitions are a ploy to ethnically cleanse the area of Palestinians and take over all of the land to transfer it to Jewish settlers. This would change the current demography of the area in East Jerusalem from being Palestinian majority to a Jewish majority or a Jewish-only neighborhood. Palestinians complain that Israel does not consider any proof of residency presented by them as valid, despite some of them dating back to Ottoman times. At the same time, there is a massive discrepancy in the number of building permits issued to Israeli Jews, numbering in the tens of thousands, in comparison to those issued to Palestinians. This indicates a deliberately biased and systematic policy which openly supports and encourages Jewish settlements of areas such as Silwan. The demolitions are also happening in complete violation of international law. Silwan is not the only Palestinian majority neighborhood being targeted by Israeli settlers and authorities. The adjoining neighborhood of Sheikh Jarrah recently sustained violence and raids by the Israeli security forces attempting to expel the Palestinian residents. The resistance in Sheikh Jarrah was met with violence and repeated crackdowns by Israeli forces, which spread across East Jerusalem. Israel also attacked Gaza in May, launching airstrikes for 11 straight days, killing at least 250 Palestinians and leaving 2,000 injured.
That's all we have time for today. We'll be back tomorrow with more news from around the world. Until then, keep watching People's Dispatch.